It was simply unexpected, and unexpectedly simple. When the curtain rose on Oklahoma in the early spring of 1943, there was only a single character on stage, churning butter on a farmhouse porch, looking out over the meadow, while, like the voice of the morning, Alfred Drake was heard in the wings.
There's a bright golden haze on the meadow.
Anyone hoping for a typically boisterous show of the 1940s was bound to be disappointed. What they would discover instead was brand new territory for the American musical. Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein II were already pioneers in their respective fields when they joined together for the first time to adapt Green Grow the Lilacs, a play about the pioneers of the Oklahoma Territory. They had known each other for decades, but neither Rodgers' usual lyricist partner, Lorenz Hart, nor Hammerstein's frequent collaborator, Jerome Kern, was inspired by the material. So Rodgers and Hammerstein found themselves working together in new and different ways. Hammerstein wrote the lyrics first, and the opposite of how Rodgers had worked with Hart, but it didn't matter. "We hit it off terribly well," Rodgers said. "We understood each other. I knew what his words meant, and I felt that I could match them." Green Grow the Lilacs was a bucolic folk drama about the settlers in Oklahoma's Indian Territory as it stood on the brink of statehood, and its basic charm lay in its characters, the amorous cowhand Curly, the plain smoking Lori, the object of his affections, and the brutal farmhand Judd, who also desires Lori. Rodgers and Hammerstein agreed that the characters in their stories had to be respected. The formula success would be to throw out all the old formulas. There were to be no specialty dances, no clever for the sake of being clever songs, no extended gags for the star comic, just a relentless quest for narrative, weaving together all the techniques of musical theater: character, dialogue, song, and dance. Indeed, it was the use of dance that would prove the most revolutionary element of the new musical, originally called, by a sort of default, "Away We Go." Director Ruben Mamoulian asked Rodgers and Hammerstein to look at the work of choreographer Agnes DeMille, who was creating a Wild West ballet called Rodeo using music by Aaron Copland. Even a folk adaptation of classical ballet seemed like, forgive the expression, a big leap for their little musical. But Rodgers and Hammerstein brought DeMille on board. It proved to be one of their smartest decisions.
I'm just a girl who can't say no.
After rejecting such name performers as Shirley Temple and Groucho Marx in favor of a mostly unknown cast, the show went into rehearsal in February of 1943, with tryouts first in New Haven. It was definitely a stressful time for the creators and the company. The show's producers, the Theater Guild, stretched every thin dime they had. Luckily, the strong narrative backbone of the show enabled the creators to make quick and incisive decisions. As the show moved to Boston, one of the producers told Oscar to write a song about the land. That's as clear as she could be. Something about the land. He got the point. The number also necessitated a title change, and by the time Away We Go left Boston, minus a song or two and some specialty dances, it was now called Oklahoma. When it opened at the St. James Theater on March 31st, the company was deep into some of the darkest days of World War II. After a year of combat losses and a complete retrenchment of daily domestic life, the nation needed to be reminded of what they were fighting for. Something about the land. Broadway had certainly seen its share of hits before. Both Rodgers and Hammerstein respectively had more than a few of their own, but in the decade before Oklahoma opened, not a single show ran over 500 performances. Oklahoma would go on to run 2,212 performances. It was the first real phenomenon in modern Broadway history. Even the songs, which Rodgers and Hammerstein worked so hard to keep within the context of the setting, broke out to achieve extraordinary popularity. "People Will Say We're in Love" was the number one song of 1943, and "Oh, What a Beautiful Morning" and "Surrey with the Fringe on Top" also topped the charts. Due to a musician strike, the original cast album wasn't recorded for months, but the album set of 678 RPM discs was the best-selling recording of Christmas 1943. The sound of the new team of Rodgers and Hammerstein traveled to homes all across the country. In the 75 years since its debut, Oklahoma has played around the world in every kind of production, in every kind of venue, including a blockbuster film in 1955. In the words of television host Ed Sullivan, Oklahoma shows us as Americans, as pioneers, as farmers. It tells of our loves and even our hates. It captures the basic urges and deepest emotions of ordinary people in beautiful songs. It speaks in a universal language. You're still doing fine, Oklahoma. You're okay.